Jesus' genealogy emphasized that he is the promised Messiah of the Jews, but also the Savior of the world. He had a dramatic birth, born of a virgin, and all who spoke concerning his birth emphasized that his coming will be significant for mankind. Jesus broke onto the scene in his 30s. There was something different in how he thought and spoke about the scripture. People who heard him noted that he thought as one who had authority and not as the teachers of the law. Jesus was not just a preacher or a teacher, but his ministry was filled with miracles, healings of the sick, and demons being casted out from people. His fame spread as large crowds flocked to him. With all these amazing things happening, people were somewhat convinced that God was now doing something grand in Israel. But not everyone was happy with Jesus. He was an unpopular figure among the religious elite. Their sharp disagreement with Jesus soon became plots to get rid of him.
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, sin of men and wrath of God has been on Jesus' laid. Sets free. Cristo, you lived to die, rejected and alone like a rose, trampled on the ground, you took the form and thought of me above all.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasure of the earth, there's nowhere to measure what you're worth. Crucified, laid behind a stone, you lived to die, rejected and alone, like a rose, trampled on the ground, you took the form and thought of me above all. Atas semua kuasa, atas semua kuasa dan semua raja, atas semesta segala ciptaannya, semua hikmat dan jalan manusia, kau telah ada sebelumnya. Atas kerajaan yang berkuasa, semua kejayaan di dalam dunia, atas semua harta kekayaan yang ada, kau lebih dari segalanya. Disiksa, disiksa dan disalibkan, bahkan mati, selamatkan hidupku. Betapa kau mengasihiku lebih dari segalanya. Mari kata disiksa, disiksa dan disalibkan, bahkan mati, selamatkan hidupku. Betapa kasihku lebih dari segalanya, Yesus.
Like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall. Like a rose, and like a rose, trampled on the ground, you took the form and thought of me
. Now it came to pass, when Jesus had finished all this saying, that he said to his disciples, "You know that after 2 days is the Passover, and the Son of Man will be delivered up to be crucified. Then the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders of the people assembled at the palace of the high priest, who was called Caiaphas, and plotted to take Jesus by trickery and kill him. But they said, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar among the people. Now, on the first day of the feast of unleavened bread, the disciple came to Jesus, saying to him, where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover? And he said, go into the city to a certain man and say to him, the teacher says, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples. So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover. When evening had come, he sat down with the 12. Now, as they were eating, he said, assuredly, I say to you, one of you will betray me. And they were exceedingly sorrowful, and each of them began to say to him, Lord, is it I? He answered and said, he who dipped his hand with me in the dish will betray me. The Son of Man indeed goes just as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been good for the man if he had not been born. Then Judas, who was betraying him, answered and said, Rabbi, is it I? He said to him, you have said it.
You are holy.
Telah kulihat bukti kasihmu, kau menderita gantikan ku dengan darahmu, kau selamatkan ku, kini ku hidup menyenangkan. Kasihmu, kau menderita gantikanku dengan darahmu, kau selamatkanku, kini ku hidup menyenangkanmu. Mari katakan, terlalu besar, terlalu besar kasihmu Bapa, pengorbanan yang kau berikan bagiku terlalu mahal, darahmu Yesus tercurah untuk menebus hidupku.
Mari katakan sekali lagi, telah kulihat,
telah kulihat bukti kasihmu, amen. Kau menderita gantikanku dengan darahmu, kau selamatkanku, kini ku hidup menyenangkan.
Curah untuk Jesus said, "With fervent desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you, before I suffer, for I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." As they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you." Let us take the bread together. Now as they were eating, he said, "Assuredly, I say to you, one of you will betray me." Judas sought opportunity to betray him. Then Jesus took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins." And they all drank from it. Let us take the drink. I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.
Good Friday. What would you term as good? Good would be faithfulness, like friends being true and trustworthy. Good would be justice scales, working right, like those in power would not abuse but walk in line with the truth. Good would be peace spread all around us. Good would be no more pain. Good would be people being there for you when you needed them most. Good would be no more crying for loved ones because of death. Today we observe what we call Good Friday, the day we remember about Jesus' sacrifice. The day we remember the kind of death that Jesus died. It's ironic though. How can it be good if we are reminded about death? How can it be good when leading up to Jesus' death, we get to know about betrayal? Right? Judas, one of Jesus' 12 disciples, who listened to him, who journeyed with him, who saw miracles, who saw healings even, one who sat with him, who laughed with him, who worshiped with him, who ate with him, who drank with him. Yet, he, Judas, plotted Jesus' betrayal. "What are you willing to give me if I deliver him over to you?" Judas says. I mean, just hearing those words as if he had forgotten his relationship, his close relationship with Jesus. How can it be good when leading up to Jesus' death, we get to know about abandonment? Matthew 26, verse 33, it says, "Even if all fall away on account of you, I never will." I mean, Peter was in denial when Jesus said that you all will fall away on account of me. Everyone else will run, but not me. I will still follow you no matter what. I think this is what Peter was thinking in his mind. He just had to be the greatest. When Jesus was arrested, all the disciples deserted and fled. And Peter made the greatest abandonment of all. Not once, but three times. "I do not know the man," he said. All of them abandoned Jesus. How can it be good when leading up to Jesus' death, we get to know about injustice? Jesus wasn't hiding like a fugitive or a wanted rebel who was leading a rebellion. But those arresting Jesus, they came with weapons. There were no guards to arrest Jesus. There were no grounds to arrest Jesus or put him to death, put him on death row. But the religious elite still sentenced him. When it came time to release a prisoner, as was the custom, the crowds wanted Barabbas to be released instead of Jesus. Barabbas was part of a rebel group who murdered during an uprising. Even one of the criminals who was crucified next to Jesus noted that Jesus was an innocent man. How can it be good when leading up to Jesus' death, we get to know about Jesus being mocked, Jesus being shamed, Jesus being insulted? Jesus was mocked and made fun of. He was shamed. Insults were hurled towards him. The soldiers, they mocked Jesus, stripping him down, put a scarlet robe and a crown of thorns on his head and said, "Hail, King of the Jews." After doing that, they put Jesus' own clothes back on him. And the crowds, they hurled insults at Jesus. "Come down from the cross," they said. "If you are the Son of God," the religious leaders, they also mocked Jesus. Said he can't even save himself. How can it be good when leading up to Jesus' death, we get to know about his pain and suffering? Mark 15:15, it says, wanting to satisfy the crowds, Pilate released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. Now, flogging, right? The Romans used a whip made of several strips of leather into which embedded near the ends pieces of bone and lead. So this is what they used to whip Jesus, to flog him. Now the Jews limited the number of stripes to a maximum of 40. In practice, to 39 in case of a miscount. You can see that in Deuteronomy 25 verse 3. But no such limitation was recognized by the Romans. Usually, victims of Roman flogging, they did not survive until the cross. They died during the flogging. So that was what Jesus went through. He went through pain and suffering. And how can it be good if we get to hear about Jesus' death. Mark 15:34, it says, "And at 3 PM, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, 'Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani,' which means, 'My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?'" Luke 23:44-56, it says, "It was now at about noon, the darkness came over the whole land until 3 PM. For the sun stopped shining, and the curtains of the temple were torn in two. Jesus called out in a loud voice, 'Father, into your hands I commit my spirit.' When he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion, seeing what had happened, praised God and said, 'Surely this was a righteous man.' When all the people who had gathered to witness this sight saw what took place, they beat their breast and went away. But all those who knew him, including the woman who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things. Now there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council, a good and upright man," it says, "who had no consent to their decision and action. He came from Judea, the Judean town of Arimathea, and he himself was waiting for the kingdom of God. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. Then he took him down, wrapped him in linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb cut in a rock, one in which no one had been laid yet. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. And the woman who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes. But they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment." Now the question comes again, why is Good Friday called good? Maybe all this, all the bad that happened, all that Jesus went through, the betrayal, the abandonment, the injustice, the mockery, the shame, the insults that were hurled upon him, the pain and suffering that Jesus went through, and ultimately death. All this was good because of love. John 3:16, it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave Jesus, and Jesus expressed God's love by coming into this world as a human being, lived with people, sat with them, had compassion on them, and loved them to the point of willingly offering himself as a sacrifice for our sins." 1 John 4:9-10, it says, "This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into this world that we might live through him. This love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." This is a quote from C.S. Lewis. He says, "To love at all is to be vulnerable. Love anything and your heart will be wrung and possibly broken. If you want to make sure of keeping it, this love intact, you must give it to no one, not even an animal. Wrap it carefully around with hobbies and luxuries, Avoid all entanglements. But this, note this, to love is to be vulnerable. But that vulnerability that Jesus portrayed, that he showed to us, should not be taken in as weakness. In fact, the cross upon which Jesus, where he died, though meant to spell the worst defeat, was actually the ultimate victory. Colossians 2:13-15, it says, when you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He was taken away. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross, and having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, trumping over them by the cross. Indeed, Good Friday, we can really call this Friday Good Friday, because God showed his love towards us through dying on the cross for our sins so that we can live. And that death on the cross is not actually a defeat, but it is God's victory, Jesus' victory for us. Let's pray. Father, as we are reminded again about this Good Friday, we get to know about the things that you had to go through to show the love of God towards each and every one of us. And even through all those hardships and pain that you went through, to the point that you died for us, you still love us. Even before we were righteous, we were sinners before that, God, but you loved us still. And now we know that we are standing here, we are living right now because of that love that you showed upon the cross for each and every one of us. And it gives us this new opportunity to live a life according to your ways. And it anticipates what we call Easter also as well. Lord, may you open us up to this grand love that you have showed upon each and every one of us as we reflect upon you dying on the cross for us. Lord, open our eyes, open our ears to hear, to be able to see, to be able to grasp this grand love that you have poured upon each and every one of us. And that is our prayer. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
The resurrection of Christ, when he came back, and then how it is good to us or affecting us, this is a proof to us that in Jesus Christ, we can have resurrection. Because Jesus Christ have died on the cross, and he have been buried. And when he came out as a living sacrificial lamb of us, this proved to us that through Jesus Christ, sin has been defeated, death has been defeated. And when he came back to life in Christ, we can come back to life after we die. Yeah, I want the congregation to remember that this Easter Sunday reminds us that only in the resurrection of Christ have we real life in Christ. Because when Christ was born, when Christ went to the cross, and then when Christ went to the grave, if it is finished there, then we have no hope. But when Christ Jesus came out of the grave in resurrection life, then we know that this Friday reminds us that we also have the victory. Even when we die, we will come out alive, victorious in Christ Jesus. I just want to remind us that when we have Holy Communion once a month, we always remind us that Jesus said, I will have this communion, like drinking the wine together with us in His kingdom. So which means He is waiting for us, and then this is some assurance that we will have Holy Communion with our Lord Jesus one day when we go back to heaven.